welcome you here to our 120th anniversary for the George Park store. You definitely want to go and take the tour and see the museum. That includes the basement too. You know, a lot of people don't ever see that, but we have one with all kinds of exhibits. And then we have arranged for the city. City offered the tram to take you on a half-hour tour of some of our historic landmarks here in Stuart. So you want to make sure you see that. So what I'm going to be covering in taking you through time are these tidbits of local history from being a frontier wilderness area, and I'm talking wilderness, to a town and then eventually a city. One of our oldest landmarks in all of this whole area of Martin County is Gilbert's Bar House of Refuge on Hutchinson Island, built in 1876 at a cost of $2,900. I had to audit that one, but that's how much it costs. And that was paid by the federal government. And the whole purpose of these houses of refuge was to assist anybody coming down either north or south on the coast. And if they had a problem, they needed assistance, well, there wasn't anybody to go to except these houses of refuge. And we had 10 of them along the Florida coast, the East Coast. So ours was right here at Hutchinson Island. And they did help a lot of people. That was the purpose of a keeper of the house, was to literally watch in the horizon to see if there was any problems, a ship going down or a smaller ship coming or boat coming to the shore and giving assistance. So it was a great thing. It was long before we had a Coast Guard. So you couldn't call the Coast Guard. You had to depend on these houses of refuge. And luckily they were close enough you could walk to them within one day, either going north or south. They were spaced out like that. So excellent, and that is our oldest structure still standing. It's the only house of refuge still standing. The others either got taken down by a hurricane, were burned, you know, all the other ones destroyed in one form or another. We're very lucky that this one is still standing. On one of our earliest, again, in the pioneer frontier era was Captain Thomas Richards. He established Eden. Now, you know Jensen Beach. If you just go north of that, that was where the settlement of Eden was. And you would think, Eden, boy, that's an unusual name. Well, that's because when Captain Richards came into port one night to that area, not knowing where he was just looking for a place to settle, and because it was stormy, and he waited till the next day, and he looks out on the horizon where the vegetation was, and he says, I have found Eden, and that's what he called that settlement that he established, and it's been like that ever since. And he was the one to help bring pineapple plantations to our area and a great economy with the pineapples. Now, pineapples were grown in other areas, not in the United States, but, you know, down in the Caribbean. So he was able to get that materials, get those pineapples started, and then he encouraged a lot of his friends up north, because he came from New Jersey, and he encouraged people that he knew and any other people that came down here, this is the thing to grow. Grow them, send them up north, and people will eat them up. They love pineapples. So that's exactly what happened. So we have the start of Eden, we eventually have the start of Jensen, and we have a post office established in Stuart in May of 1892. Now, we were basically a village. You know, when I say a town, and we're not even called Stuart yet, we were basically a village just south of the St. Lucie River. And they, being a new post office and having the trains come through, you had to give it a name. You just couldn't say that village south of the river. So the people that were living here at that time, that would be, again, the 1890s, by that time, still a wilderness, but there were a few people here. A lot of them were for Germany, and they loved that town in Germany named Potsdam. So they said, let's name it Potsdam. So the post office agreed, the railroad agreed, and that was the name put up here. So this community would be known as Potsdam. The locals, though, unfortunately ran into the conductors of the train system. As the conductors would come to each stop, station, they would call out to the passengers on the train and yell it also out the train as they come into the station, what station they're arriving at. Well, instead of saying Potsdam, they'd say damn Pots, just like that. I mean, it would drive everybody nuts. And everybody tried to talk to these conductors and say, come on, come on, come on. You know the name of this town. You're scaring everybody. But did they change? Nah, they didn't. So they had the people here in the village had to come up with another name. They said, well, this is not working. Let's choose a name that they can't mess up. So there was a fellow who had property here also growing pineapples just north of the river, St. Lucie River, and his name was Homer Stuart. And they contacted Homer. Homer was up north at that time in Michigan. And they said, you know, you've got a good Scottish name. You know, we don't think they could mess it up. Do you mind if we call it Stuart? Well, of course, the man was thrilled. And he says, call it Stuart Crossing, call it Stuart, whatever you want. I'm thrilled with it. But they chose just to use Stuart. So the post office agreed, the railroad agreed, and so all the station names and everything was changed to Stuart. And that's how that came about by June 1895. And this region, by the way, a lot of people aren't aware of this. When you say the St. Lucie River and you go south in 1895, okay, and just before the turn of the century, that's Dade County. Yes, this area right here was part of Dade County. Because there wasn't enough people to make a smaller county. You needed that many people, most of them were up in this north end, to have enough people to justify a county. Now that would change later, and I've got the date of that when we get to that, but in this time, just before the turn of the century, you're looking at Dade County. So you have people in a family. Maybe a child was born here in 1900, so they're born in Dade County, then another child born later, after we become Palm Beach County, and so they were born in that county. And the same thing happened when a child or a grandchild was born in Martin County after 1925. So they could have lived in the same house, mind you, and they were born in different counties. Oh, goodness, you're figuring that out. Okay, we had other things starting to develop here. We had our first church. It was a Methodist, but really a community church. And it was built in 1895. Now, they placed it right along the railroad tracks, they did. And some people said, why are you doing that? And they said, we want anybody coming through on that train, the passengers, to know, my goodness, that's a civilized town. It's got a church. And they even had this tall steeple on it. So, I mean, you could tell that was a church no matter what. So that building, by the way, is still in existence. We have the present owners, the Hamiltons, right here in front doing the taping. They have that church that they have and uses an art gallery, art expositions, and they are saving that church. But just think of all the people along the way who helped save that church, too. It's along 3rd Street now. It's not along the railroad tracks anymore. That was moved in 1930, and it became St. Mary's Church when they needed a church. They developed that after 1930. But and it's been other things throughout the years. He was even, for Martin County, the probation office at one time. So, I mean, it's had many purposes. Right now it's used for art exhibits and being fixed up so that you can tell, yeah, that was a church. It's easy to tell by looking at it. Our first store in this area, 1896, that was by Walter Kitchings, early settler here. He bought property here in the 1880s. He built a house in 1894, and took a while. And he had the first store here. And it was, you know where Park Store is? Well, roughly about where we are right now was where the Walter Kitchen store is. And it was very well known and just a fabulous store to go to. And then by 1901, that's why we're celebrating it, we have the Park Store built nearby, right down there. And unfortunately, the kitchen store didn't last. About 1933 was when that got just deteriorated. Not a hurricane did it, but it just age, you know, did it. So that's why it's so good that we were able to recognize the Park Store. Talking of the Park Store, again, that was July 19th. This is the anniversary. And the main floor, of course, is where the goods and products are stored. Upstairs is Parks built his living place for his family. You know, he raised his children there. He married Julie Taylor in November 1901, so after he opened the store. He wanted to make sure he had a good living and income coming in before he married. Additions, notice that when you do the tour in the museum, there's additions to, as you walk in, to the right, to the left, and to the back. He added these other additions within just a few years. He was expanding that much. Now, he was going to have his brother, Noah, join him. It was going to be the Park Brothers store, you know, he and his brother. And Noah even built his house next door. If you look, when you go to the museum, look to the house just to the right. It's a survey building right now for survey offices. But notice the peak. That's because that's how that was designed. It was so to protect it against hurricanes. And that was the way Noah designed it for his family. It was never a store. It was to be a house for his family. And Noah would join with his brother George to run the George Park store. But unfortunately, Noah died in October 1908 at the age of 35 in an illness they just didn't know how to take care of back there in 1908. And he had his widow and 7 young children. And his wife and the children stayed there in the house for a few years, but She was from North Carolina, and she says, I just got to go home to raise my children rather than here. Not that she didn't love Stuart, but she just felt more at home. So that part of the family did go back up to North Carolina. Now, the store always carried all kinds of needs, from washboards, furniture, fabric, canned goods. They carried all kinds of products. That's why it was called a general store. And the Gulf store Gulf oil products were very important. People who needed oil, and when you go in there, notice on the right side, you'll see like an area that looks raised. And that's because that's where the oil drums were placed. So, hold the wood and protect it, because those oil drums were heavy. And so he dispersed Gulf oil. And that continued for years. And notice, think about this. We had some bad hurricanes during some of these years. 1926, we had a hurricane, but not the worst we ever had. 1928, though, that was bad. That we had two of them, one in August and one in September. Both bad. So that was bad. 1928, it withstood it. You have one in 1933. It withstood that one. And then you have the one in 1949. Whoa, biggie. And it withstood that one. So you got a hand to the building that, it did well. Now, going back to Jensen was also thriving, a very big city starting to develop. A lot of people moving there, doing the pineapples also. There was the first ice plant was built there in Jensen. Nobody else had an ice plant, so it had a good business there. And the ice plant used to come by the train from Titusville. That's how they got the ice, until they had the ice plant here. So that was a big improvement. Then you have, in 1903, you have Tom Britt, B-R-I-T-T, started a barbershop trade in this area. He was one of the first railroad bridge tenders. They were the ones that raised and lowered the bridge for the train. Now, I'm not talking a bridge for cars to go over. We're talking the train. They had to up it because then you had the boats coming through. And he set up his hair-cutting trade near the end of the bridge at the north end. North end, so over the water, north end of Stuart. He accepted customers virtually any time, day or night, he was known for. Sunday particularly was his best day. And the cost of a haircut was 25 cents, and a shave, 15 cents. There you go. And so he did always very well, besides being the bridge tender. One of the most famous people in those early, early years that we had come here, starting right after the turn of the 20th century, was former President Grover Cleveland. Yes, the president was here. And he didn't intend to be. He was on a train heading down towards Jupiter in West Palm, and his train had to pull over for some repairs. So he's pulled over here in the Stuart Station. And he's looking out his car, and he sees this young fellow, and he says, what can one do in this town? I have to wait so long. So the young fellow says, fishing, fishing. And he says, I love it. Get me someone who could take me out on a boat, because he loves fishing. So the little boy did, and the president went out fishing, had a wonderful time, caught a lot of fish. And he says, I will be back. And he was, repeatedly. Especially the winter season, he was here. He would rent a place, he'd bring his wife, he'd bring his friends. So much that he eventually wanted to buy property and build a winter home. Now, where that place would be, the property that he bought, is where City Hall is today. Okay, with the parking lot and City Hall towards the river. All of that property he bought, he paid $225 back in May of 1905 for that property. And to build a winter home. Unfortunately, he started to get ill after that. He wasn't doing too well. And he died by June of 1908. So the house was never built. And his widow then sold it to someone else here in Stuart. And that person held on to it for many, many years until it was developed in the 1920s. So there was nothing on that, what we call City Hall property, until the 1920s. Baseball, boy, that was something. Everybody loved baseball in this area. Very popular men's activity. I'm not talking just the kids, we're talking the fellas. And they competed with the different communities. Palm City had one, Jensen had one, Fort Pierce had one. Everybody had a local baseball team. And some of the best players, to get the best players in Stuart, they had their own little trick on this. What they would do is have someone stand back that was interested in joining the team, and someone would toss them a pineapple. Not a cut pineapple, we're talking one that had just been harvested. So it's got all that prickly stuff on it, okay? If that person who wants to be on the team could catch it, and I mean multiple times, so maybe five of them at a time, and you could catch each one without a glove, you were on the team. So that's why the Stuart team usually won every game they were doing. Yeah. In May of 1909, the Stuart men's team was so proud of themselves over their recent victory of the Palm Beach Nines, nine as in the number nines. That was the name of their team. And because they were great players, this Palm Beach team. But the Stuart team beat them so badly that it was observed, this is reported, that those men of the Stuart team were reserved, strutting around the town like they were peacocks, you know, so proud of themselves. So that's the Stuart guys. They earned that privilege. Also in 1909, as I mentioned before, this section of, you know, Stuart down towards, we think of Hope Sound and all that, becomes part of Palm Beach County. They decided there's enough population, decided to cut it off. And Palm Beach is formed in 1909, so that's why we're part of that. And that meant then you had to depend on Palm Beach County to get things done in this county then, because we were part of Palm Beach. And that included any fixing up of roads. Now again, most people were traveling by the river in this area, which was good, but you also needed some roads. They decided they were going to rock some of the sandy roads in this area, about 3 miles worth, and they were doing this in February of 1909. It was going to cost, in today's value, over $221,000 to do 3 miles. And that's just putting rock on sand. Now, the local residents were not real thrilled with that amount of money spent. They thought, way too expensive, we don't really need this. But they went ahead and did it. So just about shows you what the public was thinking. By the way, that value back then that they had to pay was $8,000 back then in 1909. One of the new things in 1909 also was our first big school. We had a smaller school prior to that time, since the 1890s. But this would be their first big school. And it was going to be in the area where we think of near the courthouse, present courthouse, is just to the right of that, is where the school was built in 1909. And a lot of people, when they were told, the local people said, "You're building it that far out? My God, our kids are going out in the wilderness." That was considered wilderness area. Think of where the courthouse is today. And the cultural courthouse, where the arts are, right there was where the schoolhouse was. So that'll give you an idea of what they thought was wilderness then. One of the things that we had, we couldn't hold on to our doctors. Doctors would come down here and want to practice. They couldn't make a living. Nobody was sick. You know, a doctor's got to have sick people, you know. There was one doctor in particular, Dr. John North. North was his name. He and his family came here 1909, 1910, loved it, wanted to stay, the family loved it, but again, he had no patients. So, I mean, he's thinking, what am I going to do? So he thinks, okay, even though there's more people, yes, in Miami, maybe they're just sicker too. So he goes down to Miami, and he joins up with a doctor who'd been down there for a few years, and again, they didn't have that many doctors either down there, and his name was Dr. James Jackson. So the two joined together and they came up with new innovative ideas on how to treat patients for different illnesses and conditions, and they did very, very, very well. They built their own hospital, in fact, known as the Miami Hospital. Later on in the 1920s, Dr. Jackson, James Jackson, died, and that hospital was renamed Jackson Memorial Hospital, the one we know today. So that just shows where something here from Stuart spurred something else to eventually happen. You know, Jackson may not have developed that hospital if North had not been with him. Who knows? So there's a lot of influence that Stuart has had over the years in one form or another. Okay, our first bank was in 1912, the Stuart Bank, and that was operated by Walter Kitchings. We had the first newspaper called the Stuart Times. That was in April 1913. We had business buildings starting to be built. One was right there at the corner of St. Lucie Avenue and Flagler. Okay, right now that's a white building and a law office is in there. And there's been many things over the years in that building. A drugstore, for instance, for many years in there. Insurance companies, all different kinds of companies over the years. If you look very carefully at the side facing towards City Hall of that building, which is white, look up at the top and you'll see the date it was built, 1913, engraved right in there. Still there today. So a very good building that's withstood a lot of hurricanes also. So we have that one, the business building. Voters were coming out to vote in 1913. There was a special thing on the ballot that year. They wanted to know, do the residents want to allow alcoholic beverages in the community, you know, to be sold in saloons and stuff like that? They all voted. Again, it was the men, I'm surprised. But they all voted no. So no alcoholic beverages anywhere to be sold in Stuart. So that came in 1913. We have the Stuart Women's Club started, and they were chartered, it started in 1913, but chartered in 1914. And that Women's Club is still going strong today. So Women's Club started back then. We had the Lincoln Park area that was plotted out. That area was where a lot of the African-American citizens started to build homes. And that was unusual, to build your own home. I mean, they'd have a mortgage maybe, some were able to afford to build themselves. And that was known as Lincoln Park. Now later that name, that area would be known as Little Dixie, and then today we know it as East Stuart. But that was the area where they first set up a lot of African-American businesses and homes, so that they had their own community in Stuart right there. We had our own police system, of course, and one was a constable. His name was Walter W. Ball, B-A-L-L. And he was working patrol, and he was called on duty to a place where they were playing billiards and that kind of stuff in a business. And there was someone arguing with somebody else. He tried to stop the argument, and he was shot, our constable, Ball. And he's been the only police officer shot in the line of duty since that time, 1913. And it was only just recently, in the last few years, 2013, that his name was added to the National Law Enforcement Memorial Fund. This is a big plaque on it where his name is listed in Washington, D.C. So took a while, but we got it done. So we try and remember our own here. Parks, by the way, George Parks with his store running good. He added a partner, Riley Christensen, in 1913. The store name was even changed. It would become Stuart Mercantile Company. And they started to sell paint and fishing gear and hardware. So again, for everybody's need, they tried to supply it in the store. One of Stuart's most famous building contractors, and we had a lot of building contractors. Things were expanding during the 1910s. That was a big growth area. And one of these builders was J. Spears, also known as J. Spears. And he was profiled one time in the Stuart Times, a newspaper, as one of the most honest contractors that ever existed. So he had this title put on him by the newspaper, and that was in 1913. Over the course of the next month, Spears found that he had people all the time stopping him and asking him questions, figuring he knew everything, he knew it all. And he was almost embarrassed by it. And a lot of people were starting to say, so you're saying the other contractors are dishonest? He's the only honest one? Well, Stuart Times realized, I think we put our foot in our mouth then. So you gotta be careful what is put in the paper. Before becoming an incorporated city, which happened in 1914, the city of Stuart, residents used to, you know, get rid of their garbage by just dumping their debris, the trash, the refuge, off the docks in the St. Lucie River. Yes, they did. That, and then, you know, a few may have buried some of it, but most people just dumped it right off the dock. But once they became a city, an official dump area was established, and people were told you had to bring it. There was no garbage pickup, but you had to bring it to this dump site and no more into the river. So that was good. That was in 1914. So we had that vote in 1914. Again, it was only the males voting at that time still. Yeah, women are working on it, but not yet. One of the things that we did deal with in that time period of the 1910s was the notorious Ashley Gang. They robbed in February 1915 the Stuart Bank. Remember I said the bank had only been open a few years. They robbed it, okay, got away. And they did other banks. Don't worry, they didn't pick just on Stuart. They did them all the way down to Miami. And they did it up on Sebring and other areas, but very notorious. And you had different marshals and chiefs of police that had to try and catch the Ashley Gang. Was not easy. They knew how to hide in the Everglades. They knew how to get away from the law enforcement people. And unfortunately, over their years, the notorious Ashley Gang killed about a dozen people, and most of them were law officers. I would like to take this time right now for Jim Pageant to stand. His father was O.B. Pageant, chief of police of the city of Stuart, who had to chase the Ashley Gang. So that's Jim. And O.B. looks like Jim. Jim looks like his father. So you get an idea what O.B. would have looked like. I've seen photographs, so that's why I can do that comparison. But O.B. was really good. Years later, decades later, he wrote of his experiences of being a chief of police here in Stuart, what it was like, because there was other criminals to try and catch, and what it was like going after the Ashley Gang. And he wrote it up back in the 70s. He gave it to his family. It wasn't to be published necessarily, just so his family had it. When I contacted Jim to say I'm doing research on the Ashley Gang, and particularly about O.B. Tangent, he sent me those papers, rough as they were, because they weren't fixed up. There was lines and things going out, and I went over them, got it all typed up neat. So, I kept his father's same words, just made it more readable. And I gave copies to Jim and his family, and it was an excellent, excellent source to know what was going on here during those times from a man who lived it, the chief of police, O.B. Paget. Okay, so we have the Ashley Gang, and they're still going to be causing problems throughout the years. They don't finally get gunned down, and that's what it was. They were gunned down on November 1st, 1924 at the Sebastian Bridge. And again, to know the whole story of the Ashley Gang, I can do a whole story just on that, but it is a fascinating story in the Ashley Gang. We have material, by the way, in the Stuart Heritage on the gang that if you want to get some more. In 1915, we didn't have much telephone, very little telephone service. What we did have, though, was a payphone. How about that? We had a payphone in the Stuart Drugstore. That was that building where I just said the law firm is, that's painted white, right at St. Lucie and Flagler. That was the Stuart Drugstore, and that's the only payphone that was available. It was quite popular to use. In January 1st, 1916, there was a major fire in Stuart. Many buildings and homes were burnt, including a Methodist church. A Methodist church was burned to the ground. And what was funny was the story, most of the people at the time, again, this was New Year's Day, see? They were over in Palm City with a big picnic. Everybody went over there. And you didn't have a bridge yet. Everybody took boats to go over to Palm City. And so what happened, there's this little boy just happened to be looking over towards Stuart and across the water, and he yells out to everybody in Palm City, "Stuart's on fire!" So certainly he got everybody's attention, and they all rush in their boats to get over here. And you really don't have a fire department yet. You have a bucket brigade. And that's part of the reason so many, homes and places were lost in that time. It's right in that area when you go over the railroad tracks, some of that area, which is known as, by the way, Potsdam. That neighborhood is called Potsdam. But that's the area that was burned. Almost close to when you get to US 1. So from Dixie Highway to US 1 was that whole area that burned. But everybody rebuilt. But this time they built with brick instead of wood. They did learn on that one. After that fire, then you have the class of 1916. It was the first high school class in Stuart to get a diploma, to achieve a diploma. Now, we had how many students graduate in 1916? Two. One boy, one girl. And that would grow over the years. Then you'd have maybe 8. Then you'd have 10. It was speedy graduations with that, the number of people. 1916 also saw in May, Hollywood comes down here, and they make a silent film in Stuart and the surrounding areas, and it was titled Robinson Crusoe. And a lot of locals were in that movie, silent movie, mind you. But it was neat to have those film crews here during that time. January 1917, we now had electricity. Notice we didn't have it earlier. Took the 1917. Now, places up north, yes, they had electricity. We didn't have it, but we only had it in 1970 from 6 p.m. to midnight. And you did have it on Tuesday afternoon, starting at 1 o'clock. That's so the ladies could do the ironing. Yeah, they didn't forget you. They made sure they had it then. December 1917, we had a large flagpole and a U.S. flag placed in the middle. Now visualize this, Flagler Avenue and St. Lucie Avenue, that intersection. You have the train course, you got the train station, you got the intersection of Flagler and St. Lucie, and bang in the middle was a gigantic flagpole and American flag dedicated at that time. I'll tell you later what happens to it, but yes, that's when we had the flag. The only Seminole Indian, we had Seminole Indians coming here, especially the George Park store. They'd come from Indian Town, back then, and they'd take a week or so to be here and shop, and they loved the George Park store, and they'd camp outside the city limits. The only Seminole Indian ever buried at Fernhill Cemetery, which we had already by this time, in 1917, was Wildcat Tiger. He died of natural causes, and he was buried in Fernhill, the only Seminole. 1918, big news. We now have a concrete auto bridge across the St. Lucie River. Now, a lot of people referred to it as the auto bridge, the concrete bridge, or what the official name was, the Henry Flagler Bridge. But that wasn't used very often. Concrete bridge or auto bridge was really the name you saw most open, or done at that time. Now, you still didn't have a bridge across to Palm City, though. That would come in February of 1919, and that was a wooden bridge. That wooden bridge stayed there till they put the new high-rise in 1970. Now, true, they had to do some repairs every so often, but it was never all the way torn down and brand new bridge and built until 1970. This is 1919, the wooden bridge was built. And anyone who's ever crossed that old bridge knows it was a very rickety bridge, and you were nervous going over it. In December 1919, we had the first community Christmas tree placed very close to the flagpole. Remember I said right there at Flagler and St. Lucie. So a community Christmas tree and a celebration, Christmas carols, gifts given to the kids. So that was done by the city then, 1919. In the school, lunches now started to be served to the children. They would have a hot lunch served every day while they're in school. Cost was 8 cents. You had to save your money, 8 cents. We've had over the years three different Lyric theaters. Now, a lot of people don't realize that. You know, they just think of the Lyric theater we have here, but we had a total of three. The first one was over by Osceola, okay, very close to Haney Circle. And the reason they had to give that up after 1914, they built it in 14, but by 1917, they said, we can't accommodate everybody, it's not big enough. So it was the Hancock family that built it, the Hancock, and they built another one where we think of the Lyric today in that location, facing the railroad tracks, and that would hold more people. So that was in 1917. Well, again, by the 20s, Stuart is growing by leaps and bounds. Really, boom, the land boom of the 20s. So the Hancock family decided we have to build another one. So they moved the second one off of that spot, moved it over to Osceola, and built the big one that we know today. Okay, that was supposed to be big, and it was. They could get 1,000 people seated in this one. The other ones you could only get maybe 400 people in the other Lyrics. This one would hold 1,000. Now we think today, we don't seat 1,000 people in there. You seat 500 is what the seating in the Lyric is. But notice you're seating in theater chairs, theater seats, right? They were using benches back then when this one opened in 26. So yeah, scrunch everybody together. You could get 1,000 people on benches in the Lyric back then. Wasn't comfortable, but you could get to see the movie. Okay, so those are our theaters, three of them. People were investing, not just Stuart, but in Palm City and Salerno and Hope Sound. Now, Salerno came up with a neat idea for investing in property. They had what was called an off sale, OFF sale, and it was held on May 1st, 1922. There was a lot on the west side of the Dixie Highway in Salerno that the council for Salerno had acquired, and they welcomed everyone to put their name on a slip of paper and put it in this box, and they would have this drawing. Visitors and residents, it didn't matter, it could be anybody, could put their name in the box. And what they were going to do was a little bit different. It wasn't going to be the first name that came out of the box, the first slip of paper. They would say the Lucky 13 one. So they'd go through 12 of them, discard them. I think they did announce the name, so the person would go, oh God, I lost that one. So finally on the 13th one pulled, that was the lucky one, he got the free lot. He was so happy, his name was John N. Fox. He owned a restaurant in Salerno, but he was glad to have this lot. And he was so pleased that he invited everybody that was attending this, you know, drawing to come over to the ice cream establishment nearby, and he would treat everyone to ice cream. So he was so happy. Okay, another thing that was done, especially in Stuart, was called barnyard golf. Barnyard golf. Many people have never heard of that, but it's similar to horseshoes, playing horseshoes. And they would do it particularly over at the Stuart Hotel, because they had a big grassy area. And they'd set it up there, and it grew by popularity. Everybody wanted to play in it. Even in the middle of July in the heat, people were out there playing for hours, pitching horseshoes, and this was known as barnyard golf. Very popular. Now, one of our most patriotic people, he's always given this title, Mr. Stuart, and that is Stanley Kitchen. He was the nephew of Walter Kitchen. Okay? He also had a store, and he had it right along this area also. But he was very involved in community activities in Stuart. And he particularly said, we need to fly this American flag more often. He encouraged everyone. You got a house, put a flag up there, whatever. And he made sure, even if he was the only one, he was flying an American flag. Particularly even things like Lincoln's birthday. You know, any kind of patriotic moment or day celebration, he made sure that flag was flying. He wanted people to be patriotic. So that was Mr. Stuart was his nickname. We have in September 1923, a much bigger school now, three stories built, and it's going to cover all the grades 1 to 12. This one is going to cost $150,000 back then to be built. Now, if you think where the instructional center is, by High School Avenue, right along East Ocean, beyond Stuart Middle School, that building there, three stories, is the one I'm talking about. Opened up in September of 23. Now, a lot of people say 22 because they're looking at the plaque that's on the base of it when it was first dedicated, when they first started building, and it says 22. No, it was, you got to count when it's finished, and it finished in September of 23. And then they also added, by December of 23, a 50-foot flagpole in front of the school, right there at East Ocean, and it was paid for by the local Knights of the Ku Klux Klan. Yeah, we had them at Stuart, and they paid for the flagpole and the flag to be flown there at the school. One of the other big things that Salerno had was shark fishing, and that was from the 20s to 1950. And all parts of a shark would be used. They'd catch a shark, had a whole factory there, they would process it. But the big item they really liked, because it made really big money, was the liver. They didn't eat the liver. Instead, it was sent to a processing factory that processed it into vitamin A. See, we didn't have synthetic vitamin A, and a lot of people were deficient. So by, you know, having a doctor prescribe this from a factory that made the vitamin A out of the liver, people could get their necessary vitamin A that they needed. So it was used 20s, 30s, 40s. And it wasn't until the 50s then, scientists came up with synthetic vitamin A. So no more did the sharks have to worry, because our fishermen here were bringing in 1,000 sharks a week. Now, they were out in the ocean getting them, but, you know, not our rivers, but 1,000 a week, you can imagine. But there went the whole factory then, gone. No longer, because even though they used other parts, you know, the skin, the meat, the teeth, the big money was in that liver. So they did kind of close the factory after that. Now, remember I said we eventually become Martin County. That's in 1925. Now, a lot of people say, Martin, how did we ever get that name? Well, first of all, we couldn't even become a county because Palm Beach wouldn't let us. Remember, we're part of Palm Beach. We're making money for Palm Beach. We sent tax money. Now, never mind, they didn't bother to fix our roads or do anything for the schools, but we were still part of Palm Beach County. So they didn't want to let us go. So we tried every different way. We couldn't get the legislature in Tallahassee to agree to it. So we finally went to the new governor, John Martin. Now, he was originally from Jacksonville, but he's a new popular governor there, elected for the state of Florida. And we say, you know, please help us get to be our own county. We can run our own affairs. And if it's successful, we'll name the county after you. Well, the man was thrilled because, first of all, he and his wife had no children. There's no future legacy. He'd have instead a whole county. Well, the man was thrilled. So he does use his influence. It is voted in, and we become our own county in March of 1925. We had a big, big, big celebration in January of 26. I mean, it lasted for days, the celebration. And, of course, the governor comes to that, and he keeps coming and visiting Martin County for years after it's not even governor anymore. He loved this area. So Martin County named for the governor at that time. That's how that comes about. And one of the big things too in 26, besides the big celebration, was the opening of the Lyric, our own Lyric right here, the third one, March 1926. And by the way, the builder of the Lyric is Fred Walton. Mary Walton Jones, she's right back there, the head of the Stuart Heritage Museum, that's her grandfather. He knew how to build things. Not just the Lyric, but there are many other places throughout our area built by Fred Walton. So one of the neat things that I found about the Lyric is that those early years, 1926, they built also, this would be Fred, a staircase inside up to the very top, and they built a penthouse. Not a gigantic one. It didn't cover the whole roof, but part of the roof. And since this is the Roaring Twenties, you can imagine what went on. You know, it was a place to party, party, party. It'd be before a show, after a show, whatever. But it had to be by special invitation and to get access to those stairs. So that went on during 26, 27, and then you have the hurricane of 28. Oh, boy. That did that penthouse in. It blew in pieces all across Stuart. Just the penthouse. The Lyric was fine because that was block that was interchanged like this. So the lyric was fine. It was just that penthouse made out of wood that was all over the city. Well, the Hancock family who owned the lyric said, I don't think we'll try that one again. So it's never been rebuilt. Just 2 years, a penthouse up there. Very few people ever knew about that story. Stuart High School, okay? And that's what it's called, Stuart High School. Keep that in mind. Was the first high school, had a first football team in the fall of 26. The team had 11 players, and everybody tried out, and the best ones were chosen. We had our first hospital in 26, near Palm Beach Road and Hospital Pond. That pond there by Palm Beach Road, go back one block, that's where the hospital was. It was a home that was converted to a hospital. But it was only good for emergencies and birth of babies. If you had any other problem, you had to go north or south. You're not going to find anything in Martin County at that time. Remember I mentioned about the hurricanes. We had these two big hurricanes, one in August, one in September, 28, come right over Stuart, back to back like that. Good deal of damage to businesses and crops and homes. That city flagpole I told you about at Flagler in St. Lucie, broke apart. Very damaged. Now they did move it, and they moved it to what was called the City Park. City Park was called Flagler back then, but it's not the Flagler we think of here. It was farther down where we didn't have any buildings past the lyric. So they put it in there, in the City Park. By the way, that one in September, that hurricane, 130 miles per hour. Yeah, yeah. 1928 then, we have a book published about the Ashley Gang by Hicks C. Stuart. Now Hicks C. Stuart had been one of the marshals chasing the Ashley Gang during his time here in Stuart. He was a Stuart marshal. And so he wrote his experiences of chasing the Ashley Gang. And it's known as the Notorious Ashley Gang. And let's see, then we have Hurricanes, the book. Ah, Kruger Airlines, there's the Krugers. Kruger Airlines started in Stuart. They also had a branch in Fort Pierce. That's in February 1929. This company became the first incorporated company to deal exclusively in what they called flying machines. They say airplanes and flying machines in the state of Florida. The company was owned and operated by Burt Kruger, who was also known as Mr. Stuart Aviation, and also Hugh Willoughby, Jr. Willoughby was famous for flying and had even his flying license signed by one of the Wright brothers. I mean, that shows you this man knew how to fly. And they were handling planes and supplies for parts of planes. They even conducted what was called an air taxi service and a flying school, if you wanted to learn how to fly. The first airport was built on Kruger land, and what did they call that airport? Kruger Field. In the 1930s, and then with the Depression, that hit everybody hard. Things changed. It wasn't the roaring 20s anymore. Money was requested by Stuart from the federal government to have a bridge across St. Lucie replace the one we'd had that had come in 1918. It needed work. So the federal government agreed, and it was a steel-constructed bridge, and that bridge in 1934 then was named the Roosevelt Bridge, after President Roosevelt, since he'd gotten the money for that. And that was two lanes, one coming, one going. That was considered good back then. We had a massive storm, but not a hurricane storm. This was a hailstorm. Hail! Hit Stuart February 1934. Had 6 to 8 inches of hail pile up everywhere in Stuart. Now, luckily, nobody was injured. There were two cows killed, you know, and a lot of paint stripped off of billboards and paint that was on railroad cars, things like that. Windows damaged, of course, things like that. But luckily, no one else but those two cows were injured. So 1934, a hailstorm. We had the Stuart News by then. It wasn't called the Stuart Times anymore. And it had been going every day, but then because of the Depression, nobody was buying the paper. So they went to publishing the Stuart News just once a week. And that started in 34. It would stay like that until the 70s. Once a week, the Stuart News. We had a city population back in the 30s, 1935, of 2,000 people in the city of Stuart. 2,000. Over the decades, not only did we have President Grover Cleveland Fish here, who loved it, he told anybody else, and the word spread even through the generations, we had other presidents come here. Chester A. Arthur, Theodore Roosevelt, Howard Taft, and Warren Harding, besides Cleveland. All came here. This became known as the fishing grounds of presidents, this area. In 1937, addition was added to the courthouse. The courthouse was expanding. It had used the original 1909 building, school building, but they needed to expand, so they put an addition in the front, closest to East Ocean. And it was an Art Deco style, again, 1937, and paid by federal money. It was done. They got money for that. The Stuart High School formed its first band. The high school didn't even have a band until 1938, and it was only made up of juniors and seniors. They had to wear their own white pants, white shirts, and shoes until enough money could be raised to have official blue and white uniforms, band uniforms. So they started off with their own clothes. But it was a 60-member band, marching band. 60 members, very good. And then when they first came out into the football field and the audience was out there, they cheered and they cheered and they cheered. They were so proud of this new band. March 1939, a new and larger Martin County Hospital was built. Remember I said the other one, you just have to have emergencies or give birth to a baby. Now you had a hospital that could do other things. It opened along the St. Lucie River. Think of where our hospital north is now. Right there was the footprint of where this one was built in 1939. Had 23 beds and a staff of 17. That's counting everybody, from doctors to nurses to cleanup people. So, but again, they didn't have that many patients still. They would increase it as the county grew and as the hospital grew. Then we have, once we come to the 40s, World War II, a large military training camp, top secret radar instructions, and it was named Camp Murphy down in Hope Sound. It cost $15 million by the federal government to build all the buildings and clear the land and do everything they needed there. And it would only be there for a couple of years total. And in fact, I found the wording that the government used, what these buildings would be like. They'd be a step above a tent, is what they were considered. Now, anyone that has heard of any of the Camp Murphy buildings, a lot of those are still in existence and used by places today. So when they do a step above a tent, it's good. 1942, we had a local pilot that was in the U.S. military that was killed in a plane crash while he was on duty. And our new Stuart Airport that was needed because of the war going on was renamed in his honor, Witham Field. His name was Homer Paul Witham. And that name, Witham Field, stands today, named after him. January 9th, 1943, a sad day. That was the day George Parks, the owner of this store here that we're honoring today, he was working with some gasoline in the back. And there was a spark or something started it, and a big blast of fire bursted up right in front of him. He's on fire. Luckily, his daughter was in the shop. She finds out what's going on. She gets him to the hospital, but he could not be saved. He died. They had the funeral January 12th, and every business in this area closed during the funeral. That building, which we call the George Parks store, would eventually be sold by the family in 1946 to the Truman Fertilize Company, and they would be selling things for, you know, farmers and gardeners, and it would be known as the Stuart Feed Store. So that comes in the mid-40s, and no longer George Parks store. But those of us who are so familiar with it, we always still say the George Parks store, even though it was the feed store later. A recreation center, right here, was built for the military servicemen in 1943. Government built it, and because, you know, the servicemen here down in Camp Murphy, there were servicemen in Fort Pierce, they needed time out, you know, away from the job that they could just play cards and have dances or whatever. So the main part of the building over there, not this section, this came later, was built over there. And that would be known as the servicemen's building. And it would be later then, after the war, sold to Stuart, say Stuart, and it would become the Stuart Civic Center. A lot of activities for the community, lessons, games, whatever. And then eventually we know it today as the Flagler Center. Same location, same building, but it started in the war to help the soldiers. Also, here's something a lot of people never knew. June 1943, Jensen is no longer called Jensen. It's now renamed Jensen Beach. Now, mind you, you have to go touch, it's an island to get to the beach portion. It's not in the city of Jensen. But they wanted to attract more tourists, so they thought if they put the name Jensen, a lot of people would come to Jensen because it had a beach. Actually, I know it's just an island. 1944, there was a local named Fergie Ferguson. He was on the beaches of Normandy. That was D-Day, June 6, 1944. He was in the military. He'd been a great football player here and with the University of Florida in Gainesville. He'd even done football as the Army football team. He'd done that all across the United States. He is leading a group, he's a lieutenant, on those beaches of D-Day. He gets them through the barbed wire. He says, you know your mission, you know what you have to do. Unfortunately then, as he's getting through, he's hit by shrapnel in the head. He's down. The medics are a while before they can get to him. He's taken to a London hospital. He has the surgery that they can do then, in the 40s, for head injuries, but he's never quite the same. He still looks the same. He's a big, strong man, but he still mentally can't do what he once did. So he returned here to Stuart. He's taken care of by his parents, and the whole community rallied around him. Nobody ever made fun of him. Nobody teased him. They had high, high respects for Fergie Ferguson. And he did die then in 1954 from those head injuries later. So they even wanted to name the bridges when they built the bridges that were going to go to Hutchinson Island and Sewell's Point after him, the Ferguson bridges. But the Tallahassee legislators said, no, Crary has really helped get this bill passed. We're going to call it the Crary Bridge. So a lot of things were not done for Fergie that should have been, but we've done more now in recent years to remember Fergie Ferguson. The post office really got started delivering mail to homes in 1947. Before that, you had to go to the post office to pick up your mail, okay? That's what people wanted. It turns out the post office had tried to start home delivery, and a lot of the local people said, no. We like coming to meet with everybody and visiting. It's a good social hour. So finally, 1947, there's home delivery of the mail started. Late 40s, guess what? It's no longer Stuart High School. It's renamed Martin County High School. Unfortunately, it took a lot of people a lot of time to get used to calling it that. Everybody for decades called it still Stuart High School instead of Martin County. Then we have April 1948. We had a rodeo out in Indiantown. Our first one went on for years. A rodeo. Everybody from this area went to that. They had great performances. Everybody loved it. Out in Indiantown, a rodeo. One of the worst hurricanes that ever hit our area was August 1949. 160 mile per hour winds, 12 inches of rain within a few hours. That's a lot. It caused extreme damage throughout our areas. So 49, the hurricane. We had a radio station finally to this area, known as WSTU. Gee, where'd they get those initials from? So WSTU, it's formed and it's on the air by 1953. It also had one of the first bomb shelters. Gotta remember, we're talking the 50s here. People were worried about nuclear explosions, bombs landing right on your doorstep. So a lot of people were building bomb shelters. One was also built there at WSTU. Doesn't exist anymore, but I did find it once existed. 1951, we had our first drive-in theater. Yeah, it was on Dixie Highway, south of Stuart, by the cutoff road. Okay, only lasted a few years, and then you had drive-in theaters built north of the bridge. But that was our first one there on Dixie Highway. Bill Pitchford, of the Pitchford family at Jensen Beach, he made a major discovery. He'd been going to the Bahamas for years as a trader, a businessman, goods and products. And he knew all those islands. And he'd heard that there were stories of Spanish treasure chests buried in those islands. But he could never find one. Finally, by the early 50s, he brought with him a metal detector. And he went with some of the natives and they explored into this cave. Ding, 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 ding. There goes the metal detector. They dig up, and oh, here they pull out a big, heavy iron chest. They pry it open, and sure enough, it's filled with gold Spanish coins dated the 1760s. Well, man, he was excited. So he paid off the workers that were with him, and he collected all of it, except a small few of the coins he left in the bottom. He knew he had to say something to the Bahamian government, which was the British government at that time, because Bahamas wasn't independent yet. It was Great Britain. So he had to go to the authorities, he reported what he found, he brought the chest, he brought the few coins, didn't tell him about the rest. The rest of the coins he had hidden in his sails. He had a sailboat that had a motor too. So So he had those hidden in the sales, figuring no one's going to check your sales, wrapped up. So he takes it to the authorities. They say, thank you for those coins. We appreciate that. They took the few coins. He says, do you want the chest? Ah, no, we don't want the chest. Spanish chest, mind you. So he takes that. He brings it back here. He's got that load of gold coins. He drives up to New York, Philadelphia, Boston, all the big places, sells those gold coins. You right now may be wearing gold that was made out of those gold coins, because obviously it's going to get repurposed. But he made a lot of money. Nobody got suspicious of Bill. He always had money. He was a dealer with the Bahamas. He'd been doing it for years. But he didn't really advertise about a lot of it. But he kept that chest in the family for years. I found out about this story, found out that he still had a son-in-law, because Bill had died years ago. And the son-in-law had the chest. I said, send a photograph, because he had it in his garage. I said, send a photograph. Luckily, I had a description what the chest would look like. Sure enough, right on, it matched. So I asked the gentleman, the son-in-law of Bill, would you donate it to the museum? Well, he hemmed, he hawed, because he thought now he had something very famous, and he wasn't necessarily just going to give it away. So I said to him, how about if I get the Stuart News here and do an article about you giving this to the museum? He said, okay. So he did bring it. We did have the Stuart News, and there was an article on him, and you can see that chest up close and personal in the museum. Right there. Now, all those gold things that you see, those are not real coins. No, unless some of you want to leave some. But no, just fake, just to show you. But the chest is real. That's why we're called the Treasure Coast, people. All that gold going up and down our coast, because they'd go up so far and then they turn over in the Atlantic heading east to Spain. So they'd come up with the Gulf Stream. That's how that happened. One of the people that we've had a lot of different fishing people known for their fishing. A lot of people like to go to fishing camps. We had a lot of them in the North Fork and the South Fork. One of these particularly was known as Dorsal Fishing Post. This was in 1954 and very well known along the south part of the South Fork. They had cottages there. They had a restaurant. They had great fishing guides that could take you anywhere. Now, the Dorsal Fishing Post was run by two ladies. That's it. No men. Two ladies. They did a fabulous job. Doris and Sally. See where the name comes? Doris and Sally, Dorsal Fishing Post. They were so successful. They were always booked. And they kept going until 1963 when Doris became very ill and then dies shortly thereafter. So they sold it. So that was the end of that. But, you know, we had a lot of fishing camps, but I always thought that was unusual with the two ladies. The former House of Refuge in 1955. Now is owned by the county, Martin County, and is run now as a museum. That's really one of our first museums. We had some other tiny ones years earlier, but this is the first big one. 1955, the House of Refuge. In the city of Stuart, they set precedent by having two black police officers for the first time. This was in 1956, Leroy Washington and James Hall. They would continue to serve as police officers for the city of Stuart for over 30 years. First ones in this area. Nobody else had done anything like that. Our first public library. Now, we'd had a library that the Women's Club had done for some years, but this was the first really big library, and that opened up 1957 on East Ocean. That was also the same year, 1957, that Stuart officially was named Sailfish Capital of the World. We had to get approval from Tallahassee, so we put it. We'd been called that many times because of the sailfish caught here, but we wanted it officially. So we finally got it from Tallahassee. Sailfish, capital of the world. Now, the Stuart police thought they would do something a little bit different on their arm patches, okay? They had illustrated in there, you know, with thread and all of that, a sailfish, beautifully done. And they had Stuart, then you had the sailfish drawing, and then under it, capital of the world. So when you're reading it, you're saying, Stuart, capital of the world. No one picked up on saying sailfish. It took the Stuart Police Department a little while, right, David, to finally correct that and add the word sailfish. Stuart, sailfish capital of the world. Then we have September 57. Wow, wait to hear this one. There's always rivalry in football teams. You know, we had ours with Fort Pierce, particularly Dan McCartney, McCartney High School in Fort Pierce. Our high school versus them. We'd been fussing with them back and forth, trying to win games, and we weren't doing it. The last game we won with them over a long period of time was in 1942. Well, the Martin County Tigers said, we got to change this. We got to. It's now 57. It had been years since we won a game against them. So they were determined. And even though it was raining, and they were up there in the field there in Fort Pierce, so it wasn't a home game. It's raining, but they're giving it their all. They beat that high school score 20-7. Our football team guys were so excited. I mean, they could explode it. They were so that excited. You know what they did? They tore down the field's goalpost that's there in Fort Pierce, tore it down, put it on top of the bus, got it, you know, situated so it'd stay on there, drove back here to Stuart, and put that post in the ground in front of the school building, right by the American flag. And it stood there for a long time. They were so proud that they took the goalpost, and nobody took it back from them. In 1958, we had those two bridges, I said, that opened up to Sewell's Point and then to Hutchinson Island. Remember, before, the only way to get on there, you had to go through the Jensen Bridge to get onto Hutchinson Island. So this was a big, big improvement. Telephone service changed greatly in the late 50s. For years, all we had were telephone operators. You'd dial and you'd say, connect me with Mary Sue. And the operator would say, Mary Sue's on vacation, call back in a week. You know, sort of like an answer machine. But that was your telephone operators. They could do that. So by the late 50s, 1959, Bell South was changing it. They were doing rotary phones. And they built a new office right across from where the old one had been, which was Woodman Hall, which is right over here. Where the telephone operators had been on the first floor since the 20s there, operating all that time. Well, now having operators now ended in 59. And Bell South has its own rotary phones and automatic systems. No more saying, number please, by the operator. And by the way, those operators were known as Hello Girls. You know, that was their nickname. Hello Girls. August 1959, Salerno decides to change its name. It's no longer going to be just Salerno. It's now Port Salerno in 59. Again, a lot of people weren't thrilled with that either. It took a long time for people to start calling it Port Salerno instead of Salerno. Even in Stuart, they were thinking of changing the name Stuart. Yes. There was a proposal in February of 1960. A strong proposal, especially by the Stuart News. They were really backing it. They said, change the name to Stuart Beach. Now, mind you, we're by rivers, not a beach. The beach is Hutchinson Island again. There was other suggestions like Stuart by the Sea. Okay, yeah, I guess we're close, so we could call that. But nobody liked any of those suggestions. It didn't go any further. It remained Stuart to this day. No other changes. So there are my tidbits of little known information about Stuart and surrounding areas. Thank you, everybody. Also, we have the Stuart book in the museum. It's the one I put together over 200 photos.